In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Yesterday we celebrated the great feast of the entrance of the Theotokos into the temple. It is one of those great feasts that's called a prelude to God's coming into the world. We heard in the text of that service from Great Vespers the following hymns that I would like to share with you so that we can begin to contemplate on just how important and how great this feast is that we celebrated yesterday at the liturgy, but continue to celebrate over these next few days. The first hymn in the Great Vespers says, "Come, let us the faithful dance for joy." That hymn begins out by telling us that we should be filled with great joy because of what has taken place. It says, "On this day, while singing songs and hymns unto the Lord, to honor the tabernacle he has sanctified." Interesting words, to honor the tabernacle that he has sanctified. You know, on the altar stands a tabernacle, and in that tabernacle is the very body and blood of Christ that is in the reserved sacraments for the sick. But someone else also was a tabernacle, and that is Mary, the Theotokos. And this hymn refers to her as the tabernacle of the living God himself, because she bears the Christ child, who is not just a child, but the Son of the living God, the second person of the Holy Trinity, who existed from all eternity, and in fact is the divine Logos, the very one who created this world. So it says to honor the tabernacle that he, capital He, meaning God, has sanctified, that God himself becoming a man has sanctified the Virgin Mary and her womb. And it goes on to says he has sanctified the rational living ark. We know the ark of the Old Testament. It carried the tablets of stone that bore the Ten Commandments. And that tabernacle was the law. Though if you touched that tabernacle according to the Old Testament, you would die. But this is a very different tabernacle. The text says that she is a rational living ark. She's not made of wood and gold and silver, but life itself that God has created. And so she's that rational living ark, which has contained God, the Word, who is uncontainable. For as a child in the flesh, she is now wondrously offered unto God, and the holy Zechariah, the great high priest of the Lord, does receive her with gladness as the dwelling and abode of God. We celebrate on this feast when Mary was three, that she was presented to the temple of God by her parents, Joachim and Anna. And she was devoted to the temple. And there she would remain until she became a woman. There she would serve in the temple and come to know God and to dwell in that holy place. And the second hymn of that vesper says, "And the temple of the Lord today is the living temple." So she, as a little girl, entered into that great and holy temple of the Old Testament. But the hymn refers to her as the living temple, because God himself is contained in her when she gave birth to him. "And glory of Christ our God brought forth to dwell within the holies and sanctity, the only blessed among women." You know, we said that God would become a man at the fullness of time, when everything was right, when everything was prepared, and at that moment when the most people throughout all of history could be saved. But it necessitated a woman who could contain God in her womb and not be consumed. The one who reflects that burning bush in the Old Testament which Moses came upon, and he saw the bush burning, yet not consumed. And Mary is that bush unconsumed, because God himself dwells in her, and she is not consumed. And the text reminds us that there was only one woman in all of history that could do such a thing. And it's why we honor her. It's why we hold her in such great esteem. It's why we call her Theotokos, the Mother of God. And as the text reminds us, the Mother of God in his human flesh. And the next verse goes on and says, "Thou, O Virgin Mother of our God, are the prophets preaching." Didn't suddenly happen. The people of Israel were established precisely so they could prepare for the coming of the Lord, so they could literally prepare Mary so that there would be a temple that she could enter into on this day and prepare herself to receive the Christ child in her womb. And it says that Mary is the boast of the martyred saints, the glory of the apostles, the renewal of all of them that are born of earth. You know, God cast us out of paradise into this world so that we could have a chance at being renewed, a chance of becoming what God intended for us, which Adam and Eve lost in paradise. And so he sent us into this world so that we could be regenerated, or as the text used today, to be renewed. And therefore we revere the progress into the temple of God today with psalms, and we join the angel crying out, "Rejoice to thee, the all-venerable Virgin, by whose intercession we are saved." And I share with you why we rejoice so greatly in Mary's entrance into that temple and her preparation to bear the Christ child. In the Orthodox service today, in the canon, the first and second ode of that canon precisely describe to us what is about to happen through Mary, why her entrance into the temple is a prelude to God restoring mankind and restoring their relationship between man and God and bringing peace between God and man. The first ode of the Kataphysis says, "Christ is born, give ye glory. Christ is come from heaven, receive him." A reminder that that Christ child was not just a child blessed by God, but that he was God himself, the one who created this world and all the cosmos, who came down from heaven on Christmas and was born as a man in the Theotokos. But listen to the rest of those odes. It says, "Christ has come from heaven, receive him. Christ is on earth, be exalted. Sing unto the Lord, all ye earth. Sing praises and gladness, all ye people, for he has been glorified." And then in the final one, "To the Son who was begotten of the Father before all the ages, without change, and in these last days was without seed, made flesh of the Virgin." Reminding us of the child born of the Virgin Mary, he did not have a human father, but that God was the father of this child, both in his humanity, and he is the one who begot him from all eternity. We celebrate in Christ, and we recognize in Christ that he is one person, but that he has two natures. The first, which is divine, because he is God before all the ages, but also human, because he took on our human flesh so that we might be saved. And the hymn finishes, "And in these last days was without seed made flesh of the Virgin. To Christ our God let us cry aloud. Thou who hast raised us up, our horn, holy art thou, O our Lord." A reminder to us that what Mary has done this day, her entrance into the temple, that what Joachim and Anna have done in fulfilling their promise that if they had a child, she would be devoted to God. We celebrate her entrance into the temple this day as her preparation to bear the Christ child. And as we continue our journey during this Christmas fast, let us remember what the Theotokos has done in dedicating her whole life to God and preparing the way for our salvation. And let us remember where this journey will bring us. It will bring us to that cave, to that manger in which that little child is both fully human, but also fully God. And it is not only a symbol, but it is a divine act showing how much God loves us. And it is an act that breaks down the separation between man and God that existed from the fall of Adam and Eve until that moment, when God becomes one of us and restores the relationship intended for us in paradise. May we give thanks and honor the Theotokos for her devotion to God and for her being able to be the ark and the tabernacle of the living God, that we might be saved and that our relationship with God is restored. May God bless you and may He be with you.